guys, it's Spacey Sims, and we're back with more Cinderella Phenomenon, and we are going to get Rod's good ending today. So we're starting in the save that I made, like, right ahead. So we're just gonna, like, do what we did last time. Skip, and we're going to write back. All right. If he insists on being so opaque, then I'll be honest with him. I'm gonna give him a piece of my mind. I sit down at my table and begin to compose my letter. Done. Now to have it delivered. Okay. That was it. No, of course I'm mad. Okay, so hold on, we have to do both. So like, well, actually, wait a minute. I'm just gonna save this here. But can I? What if we do? Okay, hold on. Of course I'm mad. I snap at it without meaning to. I haven't seen you in months. Not only that, but you offered no indication as to when you were coming back to Angeal in your letters. You told me you'd keep me apprised of your actions, and yet you've been so distant. Rod shakes his head. You know the reason I haven't been able to keep in touch lately. In Brigantia, celebrations take months to prepare. Barely had any free time on my hands. Can we not fight? This isn't how I imagined a reunion would go. I know it's my fault you're mad, and I'm sorry. I'll apologize as many times as you need me to. I sigh. It's impossible for me to remain angry at him, especially after being separated for so long. Oh, can you go to log and go back, though? Can you, like, go back here? I guess not. And if you... I wonder if you can skip back past the choice. This is what I kind of wanted to see. Without having to load the... I guess it's really going to kind of suck. No, you can... No, you can't. All right, so never mind. I just wanted to see, like, do we have to constantly save and, like, load to see the different choices? But, yes. So anyway, no. Liar. He raises an eyebrow. I can read you like an open book, Spacey. I can tell that you're mad. If that's the case, then there's no reason for you to probe further, is there? Rod sighs and scratches his head. Okay. Town. Don't you think it'd be nice to actually be around people for a change? Rod looks at me for a long moment before sighing. Fine, we can find a way to be discreet. So, it's interesting because this is like so much faster, less conversation after the choices. But, new scene. The next day, as promised, we head to town to show Rod around. Though it's mostly an excuse to spend time together, it's not entirely a lie. New establishments have opened up since Rod's last visit. Still, to avoid any suspicion, I asked Emmeline to accompany us. Several knights come along as escorts.
It's been a long time since we all walked around town like this, hasn't it?
Yes. Emmeline has more energy than the two of us combined. She's been enthusiastically pointing at things since we arrived, and it's like weird because it's like, let's go out together, but let's now go out as a group. It's different, you know?
Oh, look! That stall's selling fresh apples!
Emmeline rushes ahead, one of the knights trailing behind her. Rod sighs and crosses his arms. You've been sighing a lot since we arrived. Is something wrong?
I just feel uncomfortable being the center of attention. People see me wandering around with the two of you and they can't help but stare.
I glance over my shoulder, realizing he's correct. I've become so accustomed to being in the public eye that I've stopped noticing. I apologize. I didn't think we'd get so many looks.
You don't need to apologize. I'd do this for you again in a heartbeat.
Though I can't openly show any affection toward Rod in the moment, I flash him my best smile, hoping he sees how grateful I am.
Thank you, Rod. There's no need to thank me. I'm enjoying the fresh air.
When I look at him skeptically, he just shrugs.
Really?
It's the last thing he says before Emmeline returns. We continue to peer at the newly opened stalls and only return to the palace when we realize the time for our dance lessons is fast approaching. Skip. Alright, so we're gonna ask her... ask about Emmeline's behavior. This is when she was hiding the ring. What was that about?
What are you talking about?
It's obvious Emmeline's hiding something. Are you in on this too?
Like Em said, it's just your imagination.
The two of us may as well be engaged in a heated staring competition.
Engaged?
In a heating stare. It gets me nowhere. Fine, I'll assume whatever this is will come to light one way or another. I don't like it when I'm kept in the dark, but I doubt either of them could ever be hiding anything harmful, so I'll let it go for now. Rod turns on his heel, heading to the nearby table to look at his music sheets. Boop. Oh, what's this all of a sudden? It's about the last letter you sent. Oh, right. I suppose I sounded very angry in that letter, but... How did you even read it? I sent it out 3 days before you arrived. Emmeline retrieved it from the messenger before it was sent out. That's true, because like in the original one we played it, he was like, you didn't send me a letter, because you're here. He frowns. I read it. I see you're still mad at me for making that wish. How could I not be? You sacrificed so much only to leave. I think it's funny because I feel like in this one, like, it's the good ending. Really? Because I feel like we're at odds and arguing and being mad a lot. And like, it just doesn't feel like it's going anyplace good, but sure. You know the reason I made that wish, Spacey. Yes, I do know, but that doesn't mean I can't regret it on your behalf. Before we made the decision to hide together, now you've made it so that you are the only one who must sacrifice everything. It isn't anger, but sadness that causes sparks to jump at my fingertips. Now she's going to electrocute him. I close my eyes and take deep breaths to calm myself. Are you all right? I'm fine. When I open my eyes again, the sparks are gone. Rod sighs. I wanted this, Spacey. Not just for you, but for myself, too. Being a prince was a constant reminder of how much I lied to the world about who I was. With this wish, I started living a life crafted by my own hands. But... Before I can say anything else, Rod's closed the distance between us and pressed his lips to mine, effectively cutting off my words. Afterwards, he pulls back and looks right into my eyes, his face flushed. It strikes me that this has happened more than a few times. Must you always do that so suddenly? Rod grumbles and shrugs. It's always the easiest way to get you to stop talking. Anyway, alright, so here we go. That doesn't matter. You don't need to be a prince to marry a princess. Rod, who had been silent this whole time, suddenly starts speaking. Not being a prince just means you have to work a little harder. The boy's eyes seem to shine with hope at the prospect.
And I'll work hard too, so I can live in a palace someday!
Whatever, that was the weirdest kid voice. Anyway, my voice cracked. Rod's responding smile is wan. He suddenly looks incredibly tired. We should leave, Spacey. They're waiting for us. Okay. Work harder. Rod mumbles to himself as he stares sullenly down at the floor. Rod, are you alright? He looks up suddenly as if I've startled him from his thoughts. Yeah, I'm fine. He smiles weakly before turning his attention back to the view outside the window. Okay. He's under more stress. The truth is, I haven't really noticed many changes since the official announcement, but Rod's good at hiding his emotions.
You ought to take more breaks.
That sounded too much like Claude. I don't know. Look, they got the same voice. Like, just whatever. Okay?
And there's no need to baby me. I know my own limitations. Thank you very much.
Chevalier and Emma still both look concerned, because Rod releases a disgruntled sigh and shakes his head.
Seriously? You're all fussing over nothing. How many times do I have to tell you I'm fine?
Somewhere nearby, a book snaps shut. Oh, and that's Cinna.
I appreciate if you stopped reprimanding me, Spacey. Meeting everyone's expectations requires work.
Not so much work you deprive yourself of sleep.
We're like too argumentative with each other in this one.
I mean, yes, sometimes you get bitchy in relationships and you have little tiffs, but like, I just feel like this is like, if this is your everyday, like, God, you work too hard. Shut up, bitch! And like, maybe you shouldn't date. Like, I just feel like we're like not a good fit in this quote-unquote good end, but...
I'll be fine. Have some faith in me.
Though not all of the old boarders are present today, we decided to make the most of our small reunion. And then we have a reunion. And now we're here. We leave. I doubt he'll open up to me if I catch him off guard. If anything, he'd most likely be irritated I was interrupting him. Stifling a heavy sigh, I take one last look at Rod and Garland before making my way back to the palace. Oops. I hadn't confronted Rod about what I saw in the forest yesterday. When we met later that day, he was so tired he immediately retired to his room after dinner.
After we had breakfast this morning, I asked him about his fatigue, but he said nothing about the practice. The only thing he said to me was, "I'll explain everything soon, I promise." Why does he not want me to know? I really want to confront him about it, but such confrontations rarely end well for either of us.
Spacey, focus.
Okay, so we're telling him to talk to someone, and we're going to say Emmeline this time. When I open my door to go find Emmeline, I'm shocked to see her already at the threshold, prepared to knock. How odd that I keep running into her when it's most convenient.
Oh, hello, Spacey. It's a lovely day today, isn't it? I thought we could take a walk.
Perfect timing. I need to speak with you. Oh, right. We're asking her about Rod being weird.
And then we should take a stroll.
Privately. Emmeline blinks at me.
Oh, of course.
She enters my room and plops herself down on my bed.
And this is about Rod, isn't it? Did he say anything when you went to the forest yesterday?
No, I didn't confront him. If he's going on his way to hide these practices, I assumed it would be best not to interrupt him. I know he keeps telling me he'll explain, but he doesn't tell me when. It's truly frustrating.
That sounds like Rod.
But we're still going to get engaged, but it still feels like, I feel like this is like a bad ending. Like, you know what I mean? We're just, I understand he's keeping secrets and we're upset about the secrets and then you find out the secret and you're like, oh, I was overreacting and like whatever. But we're still just, like, I don't know. I know that the intent is like, we're frustrated with him keeping secrets and he's like, just trust me. And we're like, but I worry about you. I'm fine, even though he's not fine and he just wants to be able to handle it. And like, I get it because it's the exact same shit that basically happened in the best ending. But for some reason, the way it's presented in this, just I guess the little more spats that we have, he's like, I can tell you're mad. I just read it as like, we're both very bitchy with each other and we just shouldn't be dating is what it is. Like, I'm just like, I don't know, you know? And maybe that's why I'm not a fan of Rod to begin with. Like, because it's not like, okay, like his story itself, I don't remember it in the original game, right? But it's, I don't think I like hated it or hated him, but I just, like, maybe it's just, even this, you're like, do we really fit together? Like the story's cute, but it doesn't feel like they're perfect for each other. Like we definitely feel perfect for Claude. Like we're a little full of ourselves. Claude's really full of himself. I'm like, you know, we're better at it now. We're like, yeah, okay, gonna level headed, be a little bit down to earth. And Claude's still just fucking out there. But like, I feel like they work almost better because they're a little more similar. And I guess we technically work with Rod because we're bitchy, he's bitchy. But like, that's, you know, I don't know. I'm not saying he's a bad character. Like, there's some characters you're like, I hate them. Why did you do this to me? They suck. Why? It's not like that at all. It's just, I don't know. I just don't feel like, oh my God, their love story is perfect. I'm just like, it's a good story. But I just don't ship the characters at all. Like, it doesn't, I don't know. And I feel like it was easier in the best ending because like, oh, look, their hat. And like, the way they wrote it, like, it was fun. The way they wrote it in, like, the relationship and everything, it was like, yeah, I don't really ship these characters, but when you get to the end, you're like, yeah, but okay, everyone's happy, and this is great. That's all I want in my stories, right? But I just feel like we're too bitchy with each other in this quote-unquote good ending. It just feels like we should be like, maybe we should just break up. Yeah, sounds good. We'll be pals, though. Fist bump. Okay. And then that's it. Like, I just, I don't know. Just the way we're, and again, I know it's just we're misunderstanding and he's trying to fight so hard, but he can't explain to us why. And it's just the miscommunication, which you get over. But I think it's just the way when I read the miscommunication, it's like we seem bitchy with him and then he's bitchy with us. And it's just the way I'm reading the characters. I know it, but yeah. Anyway,
that sounds like Rod.
Definitely does. Emmeline shifts her gaze to the window, gaze forlorn.
I wish I could offer helpful advice, but well, I've always let Rod be exactly how he is. He was quiet growing up, and I've learned to accept that about him.
He was quiet growing up because he couldn't speak. Not pull that man.
But if it makes you feel better, he's opened up a lot since he met you.
But not enough to trust me.
Oh, I don't think that's true at all. I think Rod trusts you a great deal, and that's why he struggles with ways to express himself to you in just the right way.
She sighs.
Besides, you know Rod just as well as I do. You know he has a bad habit of overworking himself. Eventually he'll crack under the pressure and he'll tell us all everything.
That's true. I just wish he wouldn't shoulder these burdens alone. I think Emmeline for a time, but turned down her offer for a stroll. I'd be bad company tonight, I'm sure. Boop. Okay. So, this is about our wedding. What would we want?
Elegant.
I'm not really fond of decadent celebrations, but... Oops, I hit the wrong... Sorry. If I'm only getting married once, we may as well make it a grand ceremony. If... Rod smiles, a little weakly.
Anything for you.
You wouldn't mind the spotlight?
I'd go anywhere and do anything with you.
I press a kiss to his cheek, and then, like, now we're having, like, a nice touching moment, and it's fine, but it's like, thank you. Why are you asking me this in the first place? I offer a mischievous smile. Are we getting married soon? Rod suddenly looks embarrassed.
I'm just asking what you prefer for the future.
For the future? I wonder how distant that is. Not that distant.
Boop.
And we're going to... Oh, okay, what do you recommend was part of the best ending? So we'll ask that. Oh, wait, hold on. I'm just going to save it right over this one because it doesn't matter. Are you sure you want to overwrite? Yes. Okay. We'll do the what do you recommend, and then we'll come back and do the buy him something because that's part of the thing, so. Emmeline blinks at me.
Me?
I want to purchase something for him that I know he'll love.
I'm sure he'd love anything you gave him.
I don't want him to love it because I bought it for him. I want him to love it because he finds it truly valuable.
You can sew, right?
I can, but I am out of practice.
Then what about baking?
I blink.
Baking? Would it surprise you to know that Rod prefers saltiness over sweetness?
She grins.
We grew up in a bakery full of sweet things, but Rod's favorite thing growing up were always Mother's special bow-shaped pretzels. It's been years since Mother baked. I'm sure he'd love to have them again.
That sounds like something your mother should give him. I can't imagine I would bake them well.
I'm sure Mother would help you make them if you asked.
Maybe it's worth a try. Rod might appreciate the nostalgia. I can give it a try. Emmeline's beaming when she grasps my hand. Here's the thing, though. This is going to change when we give him the gift. This will have baked pretzel. That's the only thing that sucks.
Mother's gonna love this! We'll go tell her after we've finished with the cakes!
The two of us resume our testing, and when we're done, we make our way to the throne room. I actually kind of want to skip all the way through this, see what happens with the pretzels, and then come back to the save and then go through it, so...
As we expected, Ophelia is sitting in the throne room, looking over papers. She looks up when we enter. Oh, hello, girls. Done with the cakes?
Because, well, you know what? I'm going to do that. I'm going to keep, like, what do you recommend? I'm going to skip all the way through until we get to giving him the present, which I think is at the end of this chapter. I don't really remember. We'll see what happens with the pretzels. Then we'll load back the save and then go through and do. So I'm just going to keep choosing the best ending things until we see what happens. With the pretzels, so.
Yes, but we're not done with baked goods just yet.
Oh? Emmeline looks at me expectantly, a sparkle in her eyes. I fidget as I look at Ophelia. I'd like to bake pretzels for Rod for his birthday. I was wondering if you might teach me. Ophelia looks surprised, then delighted.
Oh, what a splendid idea. It's been months since I baked anything. I'd love to help you.
I suppose this is meant to be a secret.
Don't worry, I'll make sure Rod doesn't find out.
We're counting on you, Emmeline. I really, really hope I can recreate these pretzels. Ophelia and I agree to meet up the day before Rod's birthday to make the pretzels. Our time in the kitchen is a blur, though Ophelia clears the area for just the two of us. I'm extremely out of my element. Like, nice, soft, fresh-baked pretzels. Oh, God. Still, following Ophelia's instruction, I manage to bake the pretzels. The two of us are in the dining hall, looking at the platter now.
Oh, but they're so lopsided but cute.
I cringe at the sight of them. They're misshapen and hardly look appetizing. No, I love them. They're like reject pretzels. I bet they're still delicious, though. Ophelia must sense my disappointment. She sets a hand on my shoulder and smiles.
I'm sure Rod will love them. They barely look edible. Perfect presentation takes practice. But these taste incredible. That's the important thing. I hope that's the case, and that he really likes these.
Oh, okay, so we ask him and then we give him the pretzels here. Perfect! Rod tears open the wrapping paper, revealing the platter of underwhelming pretzels.
I know it doesn't look that appetizing, but I wanted to try to give you a piece of home.
Spacey.
Rod looks at the pretzel in wonder. I cringe when he takes a bite out of one, but relax when I see the smile on his face. I'm shocked when his smile widens into a grin.
This is actually better. I like the plush, but I like this better. We made him fucking pretzels.
This tastes just like Mother's cooking. It reminds me of when Em and I were children. After she'd set out the day's latest baked goods, she'd make a treat for Em and I if we helped her. Em always used to ask for cinnamon rolls and crepes, but I love Mother's pretzels best.
He takes another bite, and the expression on his face is so bright it makes my heart soar.
These are amazing, Spacey.
I asked Ophelia to help me. I'm glad they turned out all right.
Spacey, stop belittling yourself. These are perfect.
My opinion is final, and you won't convince me to change my mind.
And like, this moment is nice, you know? He plants a quick kiss on my lips.
Thank you.
The two of us make our way back to the palace, and now we're going to skip back
and choose the wrong answer.
Yes.
Because we don't want to do the right thing. We'll buy him something.
Do you have anything only sold in Angeal's market that he'd like?
Emmeline tilts her head as she thinks.
This was a few years back, so I don't know if it's still around, but he was really obsessed with this old book that featured dances from all around the world. I remember it was worth a fortune. I think there's only something like 5 copies in the world.
It makes sense that Rob would be intrigued by a book about dance. He's extremely dedicated, after all.
Cold isn't an issue. I may as well go search for this book.
Oh!
Emmeline smiles sheepishly.
Sorry. I know it's not much when we think about gold we have in the palace coffers, and yet,
Emmeline comes from a humble background.
There's no reason for you to apologize. It's always better to be self-aware where gold is concerned. In this case, though, I want to buy Rod something I know he'll treasure.
Emmeline's eyes brighten.
I'll show you where the stall is after we're done with the taste testing, then.
The two of us resume our testing.
Later, Emmeline leads me to the unique item stall she was referring to. I can tell from the languages featured on his banners that the merchant is well-traveled. Even his item descriptions are in multiple languages. A traveling merchant.
Good day, Princess Emmeline, and...
The merchant's eyes widen when he catches sight of me. He bows, a bright smile on his face.
Princess Spacey, I'm so honored to meet you in person. How can I help you?
There was an old book I saw here years ago. One about dances from around the world. You don't still happen to have it, do you?
Oh, so you remember that book.
My heart sinks. He's probably sold it. It's been years, after all.
That's a very special item. I took it off my shelves a couple of years ago, thinking I'd save it for a specialist, but...
The merchant leans over to rummage through a large chest behind him.
Is this what you're looking for?
The man pulls out a large book with yellowed pages.
The book is a treasure among scholars. I've traveled between kingdoms for years, offering them a chance to borrow it for their studies.
Oh!
Emily runs a careful hand over the cover.
To think this book is that valuable!
Is it really right to purchase this when there are renowned scholars seeking it out? The merchant smiles.
Did you come here to purchase for this book, Princess Spacey? Because it'd be my honor to give it to you for free.
No, I can't. I insist.
What?
I stare at him, baffled.
No, this book is too valuable.
Nothing could ever be so valuable as my daughter's life.
I pause. Your daughter?
Had the fairy tale curse. It endangered her life. And years ago, you saved her life.
I have dispelled many fairy tale curses over the years. I rarely remember individual people, but the fact that I could save this girl's life warms my heart. It's good to know that what I'm doing makes such a difference.
And he's like, not for my daughter's life!
Are you bargaining? Oh, okay, you're saying I saved her. Alright, I was like, well, this sounds weird.
I owe you a great debt, princess.
Not at all. Dispelling the curses is my responsibility. The merchant shakes his head. Responsibility or not, you saved my daughter. And this is all but a small way for me to repay you. And then we're going to give Rod a gift we got for free.
But the other scholars...
Many have already written their research.
I glance at Emmeline, who looks at me helplessly. Are you sure you won't take payment for this?
Never!
The merchant laughs.
For this purchase, at least. But the next time you come by, I'll gladly accept gold.
Never coming back here again. Just kidding.
There'll definitely be a next time.
I agree. Thank you so much for your generosity. The merchant bows.
Truly, it is my honor, princess.
A very expensive book you're giving to us for free.
How about just a 50% discount?
Okay, so this is when we give him the book. Rod's eyes are wide with wonder.
I've been wanting to read this for years. How did you even know this existed?
Emmeline might have mentioned it. The merchant still had the book. It just been taken off the shelves for a while. Rod looks at me almost guiltily.
You didn't have to buy me something so expensive.
Actually, I shake my head. I'll tell you the story later. Suffice it to say, I didn't pay for that book with gold. It was offered to me, and now I'm gifting it to you.
I guess this is why, because like you didn't have to buy me something so expensive. It's like you bought him a nice book, but it's like, well, he gave it to me, so that's like perfect. It was a freebie gift, and it's like,
oh, you got it for free, and you're giving it to me as a gift.
Like we all haven't done that, but like you do feel a little shady. But you know what I mean? Like it's one thing, like, oh, you have something that you got for free, and you're giving it to your friend. Like, oh no, you could use this, cool, but it's not happy birthday. Here's your free with purchase. Get like a.
Rod raises his eyebrows.
No magic involved.
Not much, anyway. Rod's smile is wide and bright as he gently flips through the pages. He looks like a wonderstruck child.
I mean, it's the thought that counts. We went to go buy the book. The guy gave it to us for free. It's not like we got it. We're like, here's a book on cats. And he's like, I hate cats. I'm allergic to cats. You know?
Thank you, Spacey. Can't even begin to tell you how much this means to me. It was my pleasure.
The pretzels were the best. I hope you know we're both going to practice some of the dances in here together.
I laugh. There's nothing I'd love more. And there we go.
Respect her decision.
It doesn't matter what I think. Emmeline doesn't want him to know, and that's her decision. She's kept many of my secrets. The least I can do is keep one of hers, and this was about dating Lance. I smile. Okay.
Oh, and we are right here with Claude sparkling at me. It's like right in Rod's face, and we're like, hey, Claude. What's up, Lance? Yeah, Rod. Okay. Hi, Claude. I love him so much. He better not be in Chevalier's route, because it's going to be like, please don't be in that, because I'm going to like fawn over you the whole time. I think he might actually be my favorite.
Claude blinks at me.
What? Are you the only one who's allowed to be self-confident?
Claude grins.
Not at all. I'm just happy you agree with me on something.
Don't become accustomed to it. I doubt we'll agree on anything anytime soon.
Is that a challenge, Spacey?
It's a challenge. Yeah, hi.
Lance nudges his brother.
Please stop making everything into a challenge.
While the two brothers bicker, Rod squeezes my hand and leans in to whisper into my ear.
I'm lucky, you know. I'm the luckiest man in the world.
You are. And I'm just as lucky.
Spacey! Oh, hi! Oh, Lance! I didn't even see you there when I rubbed my breasts up against you!
I'm just kidding. Emmeline wouldn't do that, but she absolutely came over because he was here.
Rod looks at the two of them quizzically.
You sound as if you've been keeping some secret correspondence with my sister.
Rod glances between the two of them, then looks at me.
Wait. Are you all keeping a secret from me? You're all keeping a secret from me, and your secret is bigger than mine!
It's not as if you don't keep your own secrets. Rod looks equal parts disgruntled and embarrassed.
Lance, thankfully, makes things less awkward by speaking up.
Rod, may I pull you aside for a chat?
I should come too.
No, it's okay.
Rod slides his hand out of mine.
And this sounds like it'll be a conversation best had between the two of us. Man to man!
The men excuse themselves, leaving Emmeline and I alone.
Maybe if I just told him, this wouldn't be so awkward.
As I said, Rod keeps his own secrets. You're not obligated to tell him everything. I know, but now I'm worried about Prince Lance.
There's no use worrying. Rod knows Lance. I'm sure he just wants to clarify, wants clarity on the situation. All right, boop. Oh, god damn it, another one. I kind of hate when there's three choices. Like, just give me the two. Because it's like, we're going through so much. You're like, okay, I gotta choose this. So, we say he's a good dancer or he's caring. I'll say good dancer and then we'll go back to caring, so.
Oh, so I've heard. I heard he's famous in Brugantia.
Famous enough that we've heard his name here over the border.
The woman laughs.
Men who can dance possess a special kind of charm, don't they?
I like how we don't say anything. It's just like, like, it's weird.
Perhaps we should hire a charming dance instructor.
Oh, and it'd be delightful if he fell in love with one of us.
And then she's like, that's, like, odd, because we're not skipping through the conversation, but, like, did you see how, like, it's, like, it flips to me, but then it goes away? Like, he's caring.
He's an extremely thoughtful person and spares no effort in making me feel comfortable.
The women nod, looking thoughtful.
As it should be.
A man who doesn't treasure you isn't worth your time.
Noblewoman B, true.
Indeed. It sounds as if you two have a bright future ahead of you.
Yes, I'm looking forward to it. And then we part with the ladies.
I'm a little offended Emmeline told you about the letters, but not me.
If it makes you feel better, I just found out yesterday. It was an accident.
Still, was she really that worried I was going to scare him away?
Your frown is a little frightening. Rod sighs.
Fine. Maybe my poker face is a little stern, but I can't help being protective.
Did you tell Prince Lance all that?
Rod shakes his head.
I told him I trusted him. But Em, I owe her an apology. I don't want her to have to feel like she needs to hide things from me.
Emmeline is terrible at keeping secrets. I can't imagine she would ever want to keep something from you. Boop, and then we get proposed to, and then here we go.
It's good to hear you think I'm thoughtful.
That's an understatement. Sebi has said before that you're an overthinker. I agree. I know this would have been different, like, oh, you think I'm a good dancer, but whatever, we're not going to do all of it just for that. The pretzel thing was worth doing.
Rod flushes.
Now even you're teasing me. Thoughtful and overthinking aren't the same thing.
Sorry, but you know it's the truth.
Rod sighs.
I admit I have some things to work on.
We all do, but the first step is acknowledgement, correct?
Rod smiles at me.
That's right.
And then we're at a room, and what do we say? Stay with me tonight.
Wait, what?
Well, you did ask. For a few moments, the two of us stand there, staring at each other, neither of us breaking eye contact.
When you say, stay with me, you mean...
I mean that we sleep together in the same bed. Mind out of the gutter, pervert!
He's like, oh.
Why do you look disappointed? I'm just kidding. Cross my arms over my chest. My heart is beating so frantically, it's a wonder Rod can't hear it. I mean, I can't blame him for asking, like, stay with me tonight.
So by stay with me, do you mean, like, I sleep on the couch, we stay up all night and watch movies, are we talking set? Like, what are we talking about? Like, I'm gonna need, like, stay with me tonight has multiple implications. No, I mean, we're gonna fuck like rabbits. Okay, cool, like, you know, you just got to be clear on things. So
I can understand him wanting to clarify. Because if he's thinking like, sweet, we're going to have a slumber party or we're going to stay up all night and braid each other's hair and like paint each other's nails and shit. And she's like getting down to bone. It's going to be weird. I'm just saying.
Just sleep.
For now, I want to add, but I'm too embarrassed to say the words. Thankfully, Rod doesn't push me.
If you insist.
He grabs the doorknob and stiffly opens the door.
He's like, I don't know if I can just sleep. Wait, how do you...
I saw you in the forest with Garland. Oh, we obviously brought up the sword fighting.
Why didn't you say anything?
You were caught up with other things, and I figured you'd want to tell me when you were ready.
Rod groans. I'm sorry, Spacey. I've been so busy recently I forgot about the practices. I really did mean to bring them up.
There's no need to apologize, but you promised me no more secrets.
Yeah.
So you'll tell me how those practices go from now on? Rod nods. I wanted to surprise you with my progress in the future, but I haven't really improved yet. Rod, I reach out to grip his hands. How am I to celebrate your successes if I don't know about your endeavors in the first place? Fair enough. It'll still be a while yet before I have progress to speak of. But I told you I'll not keep any secrets, and I meant it. I mean it, sorry. From now on, you'll hear about every detail. They're every embarrassing detail. If you insist. Look at him, he's all blushy and red. Lovely. The two of us continue to talk until our tea is depleted. By that time, my body is heavy with exhaustion, and all I want to do is sleep. Okay. Did you want to get some sleep? Rod suddenly looks stiff and uncomfortable again. Are you okay? Well, you mentioned wanting to sleep together. We've never done that. If it makes you uncomfortable, we're both awkward. She's like sweating and he's like, no. He says it so immediately, I startle. I just mean, he sighs. I'm sorry, I've just never done this before. Oh. He's been worrying about this the whole time? Of course he would. Rod is an overthinker. That makes two of us. I set down my teacup, walk over to the other side of the table, and take his hand. Let's continue talking until we fall asleep. Rod nods, a soft smile touching his lips as I lead him to my bed. Oh. Wow, chicka, wow, wow. But it's not like that. Okay, so I'm assuming this is chapter 6 now. 4 months have passed since Rod proposed to me. Since then, he's been diligently attending all of his lessons. There's still much work to be done, but there's no rush. Every time Rod feels frustrated for not living up to expectations, his and others, that's what I tell him. Often he gets so caught up in what he could be that he forgets to celebrate the things he's already achieved. But slowly but surely, I'm getting him to appreciate the here and now. He is stubborn, but I'm more stubborn. I'm still thinking of Rod when I turn a bend in the corner and spot Emmeline walking hand in hand with Prince Lance. Oh! I love the fact that they end up... Okay. Again, I'm sorry. I can't stop. Garland and Jurian in the first game, you were like, they're going to like get together, right? I love it so much. And then every single time they're together, you're like, yeah! And now we have Emmeline and Lance in this one. You're like, oh my god, we got couples from each game. Like, I know it's about me, but like, I'm invested in them. Her expression brightens when she sees me. Spacey! Good afternoon, Princess Spacey. I look at him, bemused. I have told you multiple times you don't need to use my title, Lance. Lance flushes. Sorry, some habits die hard. He's like, no, I prefer it. Okay, Lance, you can call me Prince Lance. Yeah, not gonna happen, Llama. Lance had been visiting Angeal more frequently lately, for at least a week every month since he started officially courting Emmeline, and yet he still has yet to break out of his formalities. In that way, he is very different from Claude, who is over-familiar with everyone. That's why we love Claude. I glance between the two of them. Are you going somewhere?
I'm taking Lance to meet Viorica today. Would you like to come with?
I'll pass. I told Rod I'd meet him after his lessons.
Understood. When he gets out, can you tell him Sebby is with Mother?
Of course.
Thank you.
I thought I clicked, but I guess not. She whirls to look at Lance. My mouse just does not work right lately.
Ready to go, Llama?
Emmeline laughs when Lance flushes a bright red.
Gods, I hate that nickname.
It truly is a bizarre nickname. Ever since Emmeline found out Lance instantaneously flushes upon hearing it from her, she's begun using it to tease him. Call her Elephant, then.
Llama Elephant?
It's rude, don't call a girl an elephant, but... I'm just saying, if she's gonna call you... That was the first thing that came to my, like, Emmeline, like... I don't know, emu, I guess you could call her. Llama and emu. It is an E-M name, so.
Llama.
Emu.
Okay, that works too. I'm sure she wouldn't like it.
Now she nudges him playfully and smiles. You're the only person who can make it endearing.
Endearing?
Emmeline loops her arm through his.
Anyway, it's off to the toy shop with us. See you later, Spacey.
Until next time, Spacey.
The two continued on the hall, smiling warmly at each other. They're inseparable when Lance comes to visit.
Next week, that'll be even more the case. Emmeline plans on accompanying Lance next week to Brigantia. It'll be her first time visiting. While it will only be for a week, she's eager to spend more time with Lance. I'm happy for you, Emmeline. Footsteps echo through the corridor and I look up, expecting to see palace staff. But no, it's Rod. My heart lifts at the sight of his broad smile.
There you are.
Done with lessons for the day? Rod groans.
It was only an hour, but it felt like it took the whole day.
I raise an eyebrow. Let me guess. Politics. He nods.
Politics.
If you'd rather, you could ask to sit in on Father's council meetings. That might be more practical experience.
Not yet.
Fierce determination shines in his eyes.
I'm not ready for that yet, but I will be.
I believe in you, Rod.
And then I can't let you down.
He sighs as he runs a hand through his hair.
Still, I'm a little disgruntled. One of the original upsides to losing my title was not having to take that god-awful class. And yet, here I am again.
I grin. Classes have a way of haunting you even when you think they're over.
The break was nice while it lasted.
He exhales softly.
Anyway, I'm all yours now. What do you want to do?
What do you...
You're not allowed to reflect the question back at me.
Getting caught in the act makes me laugh. The two of us are still learning how to balance each other's wants. It's still an uphill battle because Rod's accustomed to giving more than he receives, but we're making progress. Fine then, I have an idea. I clasp his hand and begin to pull him down the corridor.
Are you going to tell me where you're taking me?
You'll see. I lead him to our secret place. A lot's changed since we met in this spot years ago, but we no longer have to worry about hiding our relationship. This place still feels like a safe haven.
I should have known it would be this place. We're going to dance in the woods.
I thought you might enjoy this after sitting in a stuffy room for hours. Rod angles his head to look up at the patches of sky visible through the canopies. His eyes shine in the sunlight, sparkling like an aquamarine. The sight takes my breath away. He looks so at ease here, so relaxed. It's a far cry from the way things used to be. But, oh, before, Rod always tried to shoulder so many burdens. I'm glad I could help take some of them on now. He turns and catches my eye.
What? Is there something on my face?
I was just remembering how this all began. How in the beginning, you hated me, and now, here we are.
Fate sure loves to toy with us.
But in the end, we took fate into our hands. Rod smiles.
For you, I'd do anything. Confronting fate was nothing.
He reaches for my hand and leads me to a boulder. The two of us sit shoulder to shoulder, looking up at the sky. When a breeze rustles my clothing and makes me shudder, Rod presses closer, wrapping an arm around my shoulders. His warmth makes me feel cozy and safe.
Have you seen Em today?
She's introducing Lance to Viorica. Oh, and about Sebi.
I know, he's with Mother.
Rod sighs.
I promised Sebi I'd start bringing him around more often. He'll probably talk my ear off if I don't retrieve him from Mother soon.
It'll be a lot livelier with him around on our outings.
And it'll keep you in check. We could be having sex in the woods right now, but Seppi's with us. Oh dear God, please don't!
Rod sighs.
I'd rather not have our conversations interrupted constantly by a plush bunny.
Even one who knows you better than you know yourself?
Especially by one who knows me better than I know myself.
He laughs, a soft sound that makes my heart flutter.
I own, though, before everything is done. So I suppose it wouldn't be too bad to carry him around sometimes.
He goes quiet again. His gaze growing somber.
Wow. All right.
I'm just going to stop reading now.
It's so strange to think Em's the one going to Brigantia this time, not me.
I shift to look at him. Do you miss it? Rod shrugs.
It was hard to enjoy Brigantia when I was thinking about you every moment of the day. What? What else would I have been thinking about?
Your lessons, maybe? Rod scowls.
Lessons, lessons, lessons. I'd like to be done with them forever.
It seems that's the trade-off for courting me. Endless lessons. Rod shakes his head.
I gave up my life for love twice. Lessons are nothing. He plants a kiss on my forehead. I already told you. For you, I'd do anything. But it will be strange not to have him here, even if it's only for a week. He looks forlorn. If she some days decides to stay in Brigantia, then it won't matter, because we both know distance is bearable if you love someone. And she'll probably come visit a lot. Red quirks an eyebrow. You were always so mad when I didn't tell you when I was coming back to visit. Do you think I should write grumpy letters like that to M? Our situation was different. You didn't tell me how long... The words fade when I realize Rod is laughing. I gather electricity on my fingertips, just a spark, and poke him gently in the shoulder. Rod yelps, then laughs even harder. I miss this. My magic? You. He kisses me again, once on the cheek, then on my forehead. I missed your passion, your spark, even your chiding. No, especially your chiding. You need to be chided. This is hardly kingly behavior. Kingly? Well, you will be king someday. And? You'll be queen someday. Someday. The word may have felt daunting before, but now it's hopeful. It's a lot easier to think about ruling when I imagine doing it by Rod's side. Rod, by your side. You're the queen. He's just king in name. Not really, like, you know what I mean? It's just weird when they say that. You're going to be the king. Not really. Together. I still have a lot to learn before then. That makes both of us. I mean, yes, he should have to do things and to be like, haha, ride your coattails, but you know what I mean? Like... Rod looks at me for a long moment, then stands abruptly. I watch as he walks over to a nearby bush and leans down to pick a white flower. He kneels before me and gently, so gently it makes my heart tremble, he tucks it behind my ear. Aww. A little pinky promise. He grasps my hand and loops his pinky finger through mine. I told you I was done with secrets. I'm done with wishes, too. From now on, the two of us are going to do everything together. He breathes in softly. This is my promise to you, Spacey. I promise I'll always work hard to be worthy. To be worthy of the title of your fiancé, and someday, to be worthy of being called your husband and king. I promise I'll make you the happiest wife. I promise that everything we've hoped for will happen. No more wishing or dreaming. The two of us will carve a way to the perfect future together. The words bring tears to my eyes. And I promise to always walk that path with you, Rod. Remember, you're never alone. I love you, Spacey. I love you too, Rod. The two of us share a kiss beneath the fragmented sunlight. Finally, after so many years of secrets, we're living our dream together. Aww. The end. I don't know what the achievement for this one was. Fated Vow. Boop. Okay. Do-do-do-do-do. This is our last CG. Aww. This is the one we got. I don't know which one I'm going to leave you on. I mean, I don't, like Rod's route is good. But he's not my favorite character, so it just doesn't spark as much joy for me as, like, doing some of the other ones. But I just realized, like, there's a black line over here. We should end on this one. It looks more like Rod. There you go. We're getting proposed to. Look, you're getting proposed to! This is the one we'll end on. Anyway, yeah, so I'll wrap this up here because it's the end of this part, and we will probably... like, Waltz is supposed to be, like, Cannon Boy, but I don't know, like, and I forget where I read that, but it was, like, I don't know if I got that sense in the first one, because it's been so long since I played it, I don't know. I know we had to do him toward the end, but I do feel like maybe we'll do Chevalier next, and then Waltz, and then we'll do Fritz, because, like, poor Fritz, he's, like, fucking dead in every round, like, that poor motherfucker. So I feel like maybe we should end on him and be like, nah, there you go. But yeah, so next time we'll be back with a new route. So I will see you guys next time. Remember to give the video a big thumbs up and subscribe to see more.